higher frequency classes.
Okay, thank you very much for the invitation here. So I will be talking also about true representation theory. Daniel did before, but I'll be talking about a much easier setting. So actually, I started true representation theory looking at several categories of bimodules. It was just too hard in some sense. So then I switched to Lie algebras, and that was easier. So representations of even the symmetric group, I mean, which is somewhat easy case in what we saw before, it's much harder to construct irreducible representations of symmetric groups than it is to construct, say, finite-dimensional irreducible representations of complex semi-simple algebra. Okay, it's much easier. You have this much more concrete somehow theory. And if you talk of other Weyl groups, it's even harder than symmetric groups. Even so, I mean, the end result is not so bad, but the theory is not as smooth as the algebras. And when you go to the categorical setting, then it's that's where you see a huge difference. The least theoretic setting, all those things about finiteness, Schoenwalder, etc., are fairly straightforward, but there are so far a stumbling block in this circle bimodule setting. Okay, so let me first explain why this what I will be discussing can be relevant to topology and where it goes back. So it has to do, say, with higher categories and topological field theories. So I'll be very sketchy. So what you can do, you can take a finite group, and you can build a 2D field theory out of your finite group. So you can say, oh, the group algebra of complex numbers of my finite group is a Frobenius algebra. Or you can say, you're looking at some topological objects and at maps from its fundamental group to your finite group. So there are various ways to build field theories out of finite groups or compactly groups. So then it's harder. Let me state things in terms of Lie algebra, maybe a classical say representation theory, say the algebra G. Well, it's somehow related to 2D topology. Again, if you have a true finite group, not a positive dimensional compactly group, you can look at the group algebra as a Frobenius algebra. And there's not tons to say about it. So now, what things get interesting when you look at quantum representations, the representations of the quantum group. So it's known to be related to 3D topology. That's Witten, Rishitikin to IF. And you see the three-dimensional aspect is seen already at the level of knots inside S3, or even at the level of bread. So you get invariants of bread, and that comes from the R matrix. And the R matrix itself comes from the fact that if you look at, say, from representations of your quantum group to vector spaces, say, this functor, you just forget the structure, commutes with tensor product. It's a tensor functor, but not with the braiding. So when you take two UQ of G modules, V and W, there's an isomorphism between V tensor W and W tensor V, given by the R matrix. And this is not just switching components of the vector spaces, okay? So you can identify these two vector spaces by just switching components, but that will not be compatible with the UQG action. So here, of course, there isn't this setting. So if you go from, say, G mod to vector spaces, this commutes with tensor product and with, say, with a braiding. I mean, these are both symmetric monoidal categories. OK, so that's a classical picture. So some of the three-dimensional invariants, whatever, is there are, I mean, at least on the first approximation, they come from the R matrix. And you need a twist, you need a number of things to go from invariants of breadth to invariants of knots. And then you need to average over colorings to get to invariants of three manifolds. But some of the most complicated, probably, piece of information is the R matrix. So now, what about two representations? I'm lucky that Daniel just gave a talk explaining a bit the general setting. So this is expected to be related to 4D topology. And let me write Krein-Frankel. So there's no question. It is an idea of Krein-Frankel. The question that there was a proposal, and they conjectured that while you can get invariants of three-dimensional manifolds from representations of quantum groups, if you were to replace vector spaces by categories, maybe you could get things like a Donaldson invariant at the time. And so the best evidence is the Kovanov homology, which is definitely four-dimensional in flavor. And say in its original incarnation, it has to do with SL2. So the hope is that there is a four-dimensional field theory that for knots in S3 returns a Kovanov homology for SL2, and that for four-dimensional closed manifolds would be something like maybe the Donaldson invariant, something that really detects smooth structures. And so another more recent feature is that so there is something that's very close to being a four-dimensional TQFT. That's a Heegaard-Fleur theory. And so SL2 invariants of knots categorifies the Jones polynomial. Heegaard-Fleur homology of knots categorifies the Alexander polynomial. And this is known to have to do with DL11. So it's super Lie algebra. And I will explain in the last part of the talk that indeed, part of Heegaard-Fleury now can be viewed as fitting within two representation theory. So these two things, Kovanov homology and Heegaard-Fleur theory, have, I mean, this fits within two representation theory, and the most, some more elementary parts of Heegaard-Fleur theory also now can be viewed as fitting with two representations of GL11. So now from the point of view, so we are not looking now at representations on vector spaces, but on categories. But there is a forgetful functor. If you have a category with, or a bunch of algebras with some actions, you can forget the action. And then, so I explained, I mean, there are you can take tensor products of those things, like you can take tensor product of UQG modules. And so you can go from two representations of whatever structure you're studying to categories. But this is now not even going to commute with the tensor product. Not. So in other terms, so here in the quantum group case, if you take V and W representations of the quantum group, you can form a new representation V tensor W. And the underlying vector space is determined just by V and W as vector spaces. You don't need to remember the representations. Whereas here, if you have, say, categories V and W with a structure of two representations, you can form a new structure, a new V tensor W with two representations. But that new V tensor W is not determined by V and W as categories. You need to know more. Okay. So going from 2 to 3, you have a problem not with the tensor product, but the braiding. Is not, I mean, something new somehow. And here, when you go to dimension 4, even the tensor product with something new. Right, so let me try now to be a bit more concrete and explain two representations of SL2. So that goes back to work a little over 10 years ago with Zhuo Shuang. So SL2C as a Lie algebra as a basis with usual three generators. Let me write E as this one, maybe. And it's a fact that finite dimensional representations of SL2C embeds in there, representations of the Borel part. So it's a general thing of finite dimensional or weight representations of semi-simple algebras is that once you know the action of E and H, the action of F is uniquely determined if it exists.
Okay.
Just to say that and H acts by a scalar on weight spaces. So when you look at representations of the Kac-Moody algebras in general, it's just the E somehow that you can focus on. I will be talking mostly about E, but the F somehow is given. And if you think of compact Lie groups, rather, you can look at unitary representations. And on the unitary representations, E and the F will be adjoint. So you know, if you know the action of E, you just take F as the adjoint. So that's the feature. So my two representation theory so far is really doing unitary representations of the complex group. Oh, well, I mean, say of finite dimensional representations of the compact group. Okay, so what is the let's say A is an algebra. So a two representation of SL2 on A is there is some data. So the data is the data of a bimodule. So a bimodule, you can tensor with this bimodule, so it will send an A module to another A module. It's like the action of small e on the vector space. And the data of X, an endomorphism of this bimodule. And tau, an endomorphism of E tensor E. So that's the data you need, okay? So there are certain conditions that need to be satisfied, but it's important that to see that in the data there is one part which is the usual, some of the usual actions that you will see when you decategorify if you want the E, but there are some higher symmetries, and that's really where the interesting algebra somehow comes. There are some higher symmetries is really controlling the controlling things, so such that. So first, so what algebra is happening? Well, when you look at endomorphism, say of E tensor over AE of two bimodules, and you have X and endomorphism of E, so you can let it act on the first or on the second copy of E, and so you end up with a three endomorphism of E tensor E. You have tau and X acting on the first copy. And there are some relations they should satisfy. So first, tau. So there are various ways you can describe things. One of those is requiring that tau squares to zero. And then inside the endomorphism ring of E tensor E, you ask the following relation. Uh, And that should be also equal to so you require this equality. And finally, you require that tau satisfies the Bread relations. So you can take E tensor E tensor E three times. And then you have two ways to. So you're swapping the extreme terms. And you can do that in two ways. So you can apply tau on the first component and then the identity of E. Or you ask this diagram commute. Okay, so that's a usual Bread relation. So that happens as endomorphisms of E tensor E. Okay. Do E tensor E, and you can. So it looks like a bit like tau would be a braiding in a braided module category, except that it squares to zero, so it's opposite to being being an isomorphism. So that's this is the important some part, the two arrows, le verbe, but you need also you need to be a little bit careful that you would want to have just not an E, you would want to have an F or whatever. So F is going to arise as an adjoint to E, and you would want the left and right adjoint to coincide. So these two functors are adjoint, but only in one direction in general. So I ask that they are biadjoint. Okay, so that's a requirement. I mean, if you have categories of symmetric algebras or Calabi-Yau settings, et cetera, up to a shift, you will be. So I'm not doing the most general definition. Induce an action of SL2C on the complexified Grothendieck group of say finite dimensional A modules. So this will be E will be, so we'll maybe assume that this functor is exact, and so is this one. And E and F generate SL2C. And then you should throw in some finiteness assumptions to make sure that otherwise, there is a definition that does not assume any finiteness assumption, more complicated. So I don't want to, you want big power of E to be zero, you want maybe some local finiteness, etc. Okay, so this came from strong with work on symmetric groups. We realized that this structure was controlling things. So what Daniel in his talk earlier explained is that for him, an important problem was to try to classify simple two representations. So in this situation, it's easy to show that that there are so have a Jordan Holder a simple true representation. There will be a unique one, let's call it L of N for N positive, where there's a Grothendieck group of L of N would correspond to a complexified Grothendieck group, will be the irreducible N-dimensional representation of. Maybe I should do that. Sn. Okay, so N equal, L of 0 is a trivial representation. L of 1 is a two-dimensional non-trivial representation of SL2. So all those things are not too difficult to show. And this is something we used originally by, we had a problem with representation with symmetry groups, representation of symmetry groups. And we showed that there was a structure of two representations of SL2. We had to prove something, and we could prove that, we could deduce that property for this specific two representation. We could deduce it from the fact that we knew it by an explicit computation that this was true for L of n. So we have a we want to prove something about an explicit category and reduce the problem to the case of simple two representations where we do an explicit calculation. So this idea is that being able to reduce to simple two representations, a classical idea in, say, maybe in representation theory, was something was that somehow drove us to develop that theory. So now examples, and this extends maybe, this extends, all extends to SL2 replaced by Katz-Moody algebra. So an example. Would be to take as an algebra A, so the direct sum, direct product of, I take a polynomial ring in n variables, and I take invariants under this Young subgroup. So that's equivalent cohomology rings of Grassmannians. And so E, I mean, it's a product of algebra, the module category of A is going to be a direct sum. So by module E is decomposing as a direct sum. And E will be obtained by taking a sum of of invariants now by Si times S1 times S n minus I minus 1. So just putting, I'm putting this S1 there just to explain that this is acting on the last variables. And this contains, so gives an action by multiplication, this invariant ring and this. Okay, these are sub-rings and they act by multiplication. And so this gives the structure of AI by module on E, okay. Left action and right action that commute by multiplication. So now X here is going to be given by some of the variables that, that's still there. So X is acting by multiplication by, so on this given component, it's going to be multiplication by Xi plus one. And now we have to tell you what is a tau. So if we do a tensor product Pn fixed by say Si, Sn minus I minus one, so do, we do E tensor Ae, it's going to decompose as a direct sum. And then I have to tensor over Pn fixed by Si plus one. Okay, so that's the terms. So all those live in a bigger bimodule, and if you just multiply, you're going to get an isomorphism with Pn fixed by Si times say S1, S1. Okay, so that's an isomorphism. It's easy to check. And now tau is acting there as an onomorphism of bimodules. So we have a left, sudden left action, right action. So there's an action of tau. Let me write it there. And it's determined by its action on one here. One is mapped to zero. And xi plus one is mapped to one. So this determines our tau. So tau is some sort of derivative. It's a discrete derivative with respect to xi plus one and xi, minus xi plus two. So anyway, so this determines everything, and this gives a two representation of SL2. And so this, if you look at finite dimensional representations of A on which there's a maximal ideal of polynomials with a non-zero constant term on which they act nilpotently, you will get, so if you look at C, A modules where they, maybe all that fixed by SN acts nilpotently. So the simple module there, that means just it's going to be always the trivial module with the xi's acting by zero. C tensor, so I'm cheating a little bit. The Cauchy group itself is going to be, I mean, it would be fine in this case, maybe. C tensor k0 of C, that's to be in the finite. In the case where our categories have finite Jordan under series, this will be identified with C to the n plus 1. And so what we have obtained there is a categorification of the n plus 1 dimensional representation. Okay. Right, so this is a very basic example. And these here, some are the simple two representation. And every two representation with finiteness condition is an extension of, well, you have to do L of n, but you have to also allow for some multiplicity category, which will be over the center of those rings, et cetera. So there's some base change involved. There's a nice description of all of that. And so now, so if you want to move to other Katz-Moody algebras or even to SLNs, things get more complicated. And the generalization of some ring with these relations are, for general Katz-Moody algebras, are these are quiver Hecker algebras. And the generalization of those rings are cyclotomic quiver Hecker algebras. Okay. So quiver Hecker algebras have to do with Borel and cyclotomic quiver Hecker algebras with simple representations. Okay. So now this thing there, remember SNC2 is something that sits inside C2 tensor N as a representation. So it would be good if we could, I mean, for C2, the case of the algebra A is just two copies of K of X, K of X1. So is my N correct? Yeah. So it would be good if we could have a way to make the tensor product. So we would have this something fairly complicated there that contains this interesting thing out of something very very elementary. Okay. So for K of X, for n equals one, A is we'll have two copies of K of X. And E is just K of X. So there's no tau, and X is just X as a bimodule, just the identity functor. So it's a very trivial structure. But the idea is that we can make, it makes sense to take the nth tensor power of that. And that's what I will explain now. So let's assume we are given two representations of SL2. So you could also start with, it's a bit better to take as I did, a categorical point of view where we have maybe an abelian category and exact functors or something like that. For the, I chose to do what I have because when I give the example, it's really in terms of bimodules. So we can define a tensor product of those. So it's not, I mean, not usual tensor product. So you put a double circle. I as follows. So what is the new underlying algebra? So that's where something interesting is going on, as you, if you remember what I said at the beginning. So the fact that this doesn't commute with tensor product, that means the underlying algebra is not going to be the tensor product of M1 and M2. It's going to be more complicated. So let me first introduce a triddle. So it's going to be the tensor algebra of a certain module, certain bimodule over A1 tensor A2. And that bimodule is E1 dual tensor E2. So E1 dual we have a left action of A1 on E1, and so if we do that, we still have a bimodule by using the right action of A1 on itself. And the right action of E1 on itself becomes, of A1 on E1 becomes the left action of, so that's still an A1, A1 bimodule. So the tensor algebra means that's A1 tensor A2. I mean, the things don't commute. It's not a symmetric algebra. E1 and E2 more commute, but not a... Okay, so that's potentially fairly big. And now A is going to be a quotient of that tensor algebra. So we have an endomorphism X of E1, we have an homomorphism X of E2. And so what we require is that, so X can act on the, can act here, it can act, it acts on E1, so it's going to act also on E1 dual. So we act, we require the action of X here, the same as the action of X there, okay. So we're going to divide by the fact that if we apply X to an element, HH1, tensor E2 minus E1 charge, tensor X of E2 is zero. And we require on this term that the action, so we have an action of tau here. We're going to get also an action of tau here. We require that the two actions coincide. So we're going to divide by the two-sided ideal generated by those elements. Okay, so that's the definition of A. So now we need to define E. So E is not a bimodule anymore. It's a complex of bimodules. So, yes? So normally I don't do formulas. I give the intuitive approach. So I think one of the first time today that after many years I decided to give a formula. So the idea is that tensor product is bad. You should think that you have maybe A1 and A2, two categories with an action of 2 rep SL2. And you're trying to do some sort of internal HOM from A1 and A2. Let me write whatever. Instead of tensor product, better to think of HOM. What you know is that you know what is. You know what this should be. That Daniel didn't give his explicit, I think, description, but he says there is a two category of two representations. Well, you should look at functors from A1 to A2. But you should also require that there should be, that it, the functor commute with the action. So that means there should be an isomorphism between, first you apply your E1, and then you do plus compatibilities. But as far as data goes, in the category of two representations of SL2, a map, one arrow, is a functor together with the commutation data. It's part of the data, okay? So now if you want to go to, if you're asking what is this, well, this internal hom is going to contain the hom of RSL2 as some sort of fixed point. And what is the difference between this and this is that you, it's exactly the same definition except that you drop that alpha should be invertible. Here, so you drop invertibility of alpha. Okay, I don't know why I write in pink, but anyway. Okay, so if you interpret that in terms of bimodule and you do that, whatever, you get that. So just explicit. It's just, it's very confusing, but if you do, so I'll explain a little bit GL11, and then there are arc algebras, strand algebras of Lipschitz, Ozar Sabo, and you get them explicit on the nose by using this description. So what is E now? Well, you need, we know that in a Lie algebra, the coproduct of a Lie element is of small e, say NSA2, is e tensor 1 plus 1 tensor e. So here I have done something a little bit strange. I don't want to tell you about. I'm really looking at the hom. There are some shifts, etc. Putting all that under the carpet, so it's going to become e tensor 1 minus 1 tensor e. And so the complex we get now is ring. Okay, so so this can be viewed as a AA bimodule. So I'm not going to talk too much about that. And what's important is the map there. What is this map? This map, the differential, is the adjoint to the following, which is just a multiplication map. I mean, we are in this algebra A. This sits inside A. Okay, but in the integral, then we take the quotient. Okay, so this comes from the multiplication in A. And so this multiplication there, you move the E1 becomes on. Moves to the right by adjunction, so that gives a differential. Okay, and then there is an X. Well, it's just a matrix where you put something like this, maybe. The tau is slightly more complicated. It's going to be a matrix like tau. There's a 1 sticking around somewhere there. But so you can like that get a new tau representation, except that it's not quite true. So you get almost two representations. So you have to be a little bit careful that now E is a complex of bimodules. The original theory, you take a bimodule, so you're forced to switch to complexes when you do that. Okay, fine. But the more serious problem is that this is supposed to be an anomorphism of X of E as a bimodule, but it's not. It's a complex of bimodule. It's only an anomorphism in the infinity sense. So X is only an infinity anomorphism of E. So what you get, something you can call an infinity two representation. So you can try to fix that by making everything, I mean, somehow, so things commute somehow up to homotopy, whereas natural transformation of functors should be something that commutes, not just up to homotopy. So you can try to fix that, but then everything becomes extremely big. You have to take bar resolutions everywhere, and that's not good. So somehow you're forced to move to an infinity world for tensor product for SL2. So that's the way things are. So if you're lucky, if there are canonical bases somehow in this situation for A1, A2, you might have a canonical basis in A, so that means there will be another, there will be an algebra derived equivalent to A-twiddle for which E will become a nest bimodule. So that's one way to get rid of the A infinity problem. So let me now move to what one can do with that.
definition. We can still use it.
Yes.
Yes,
that's exactly what I'm going to do. Yes. So, example. If you take, say, k of x plus k of x, as I explained, if you take, let's go directly, be bold, this will be two representation of SL2, and it will indeed solve our problem. So this will contain the A from the example. From example above, say, as a sub to representation. So from a concrete point of view, so let me, to answer your question, Joel, so let me do rather k plus k tensor 2. So in this case, I take E as the identity. X is 0 and tau is 0. There's no tau because E square is 0. So if you take the tensor square of that, we know what we should get. There should be three white spaces. And so we'll have one copy, which will be just k. We'll get k. And in the middle, we get things that have various incarnations. One is the principal block of SL2. So it's a quiver algebra. For a quiver with two vertices. So this is a derived equivalence. So when I say content, I do mean that. So there is you're going to get here DG algebras. I mean, here you get K and K as bottom and top weight spaces, but in the middle you get something which is not quite that. So somehow this makes this tensor product interesting. And you start out with something semi-simple, and you get something that's not semi-simple. So there are many examples of categorification of tensor products that have been built by hand. I mean, the first are using Nakajima quiver varieties, and then there's a family of algebras constructed by Ben Webster. It still needs to be, they should be equivalent to tensor products, but that hasn't yet been done. One reason is probably because I haven't yet written a paper on that. It doesn't help. But that it is difficult to manipulate, a little bit difficult to manipulate these objects because of the A infinity business. So one more thing you can do is actually construct an R matrix. So in general settings, there exists a categorification of R matrix. So what does it mean? It means if you do a tensor product with M shortening the notation. So you can define something that will be like that. Whatever it means, I mean, that's, let's say it's a derived equivalence. I should put it like that. So it can be defined in a homological algebra manner, some sort of causal, relative causal duality, or with an explicit complex. And the fact that it's not too hard to make sense of it is we're in a situation where we've taken basically a double, like Grünfeld double construction. In this case, the R matrix is very, very easy. So you just mimic that. But then things get a little bit out of control. So you can still check that on the example there, you recover Kovanov homology. So that's okay. So at least, so using these two representation, so you would have you have n minus one R matrices. You can use them to get invariants of Brent, and this is a Kovanov's theory. So okay, so this theory is a little bit difficult, it's not too difficult to define the new A, it's not too difficult to define the new E, but X there is problematic. You can check as an exercise that this X does not define an endomorphism of bimodules. It's commuting with the action only of two homotopy. Okay. So things get better if you move to the last part, Mato. Yes? So it's is it Kovanov algebra somehow doesn't, you don't, I mean, you see directly the, you connect somehow with Thurgood bimodules, et cetera. I mean, it's so you will, I mean, you will get the homology itself. So let me remember the Kovanov algebra. Yeah, so that's the Kovanov, yeah, no, I think, I mean, this is connected to the old work of what, Katrina, Stroppel, and things like that. So it goes through those steps. So it's not a direct connection, okay? So it's, there might be a better way to, as you suggest, to connect directly with Kovanov algebra, but I don't know how to do that. So that's a good question. Try to see. They do occur, something related to Kovanov algebra occurs. But yeah, it's a little bit tricky to, I don't know, to see them directly from this picture without connecting first to Thurgood bimodules, et cetera.
Yes. Kind of relates to that question. The middle is
yes.
Trivial block muscle too. I mean, here it's a little too small. Do you think of this as singular category or parabolic category for a bigger example?
I don't know. So I mean, yeah. It's not in this T structure anyway. It's another T structure, so I don't know which of the two would be reasonable. Yeah, I don't know. I tend to think of parabolic because it's a little bit easier, but maybe the other one's more natural. No, that's this is a, there are questions there about T-structures, about guiding causal duality, et cetera. And it's, in this case, it's, in some sense, this case is particularly problematic because there are lots of things happening. It's a very rich some more example. Okay, so now I'll move to the final part, will be GL11. So it's very similar to GL11 plus. So the Lie algebra, the positive part of GL11 is so U of GL11 plus is just C of E. It's an odd, E is odd. So we're categorifying this algebra. And that's something that Kovanov thought about 15 years ago or something like that, inspired by Edgar Fleur people. And and it's, to categorify, you do, it's similar to somehow same as SL2. You have an E, but there is no X. And there is a tau, but now there's a differential, and d of tau is 1. Okay, so you have an action. So if you look at the definition that's still there, you have an x, there's an Hilbert module, there's no x, sorry, there's a tau, and there's a braiding, but there's no. But now you need to assume that everything has a differential, and d differentiate to 1, so that means that as soon as there is a tau, 1 will become the differential of something. So that means, for example, that E square is going to be acyclic, zero cohomology, because it's identity. The identity endomorphism is D of something. So it looks fairly, from the up to quasi-isomorphism, it's somewhat silly. But a good point is that you can also do, you can do tensor products somehow of two representations. I should say it's joint work with Andy Mannion of two representations of GL11 plus. And the amazing fact is that because there is no X, there is no more of this A infinity difficulty. So it's much better. You can define a honest, I mean, this type of definition, so the X disappears. Definition works, does really work on the nose. So the only, there is a complication from the start. is that you're never going to be able to work only with algebras. You only have to work, you always have to work with differential graded algebras, okay? So, but need differential graded algebras all the time, but that's what Eckhard Fleur people do. So, SL2 GL11. So GL11 is much better to start. It's a little bit more problematic because you need DG. And there is a more, there's a big stumbling block so far. Something we haven't yet somehow pursued is that we, I said for SL2, well, you deal with, we deal with E and then F is going to be the adjoint, you make some requirement. So things are more complicated with GL11. So we haven't yet a definition of what is the two representation of GL11. We know GL11 plus, but we are missing the other side. Yes?
How do you know there's no F? Like, what's the intuition behind that?
Well, the intuition is that there is somewhere, I don't know, there's some kind of odd line bundle and it has no first chain class or something like that. So, I wish I could make sense of that, but it's something like that. So, So SL2 or Katzmoody, you have algebraic geometry models. So for in the super case in GL11, there is no such model. So there are Foucault symplectic geometry models. But there is no such line bundle. So the best you could hope somewhere is something having to do with maybe Z-mod 2 or. Instead of something like C star, so it's not clear. So what's possible? It's fairly convincing that from the Foucault point of view that the holomorphism of E should be just K, but maybe there's a way to enhance things. So that there's a DG algebra that's quasi isomorphic to K, so there will be an X. But the X somehow will be the D of some, would disappear, would not appear in cohomology. So in the symplectic setting, it doesn't seem to be coming, but in the contact geometry setting, there is there could be something like that. So it would have to do. If there's an X in GL11, it might be something acyclic or with a differential zero, but it will have to do with contact structures probably. So I will be talking about symplectic, extra structures having to do with symplectic structures on spaces in sentence or things like that, but the contact geometry is probably relevant. So let me explain how this has to do with field theories and Eckhard Fleur. Finish with that. So if you look, so Eckhard Fleur. So if you take four-dimensional closed manifold, you can associate a number. Oops, sorry. So I don't know if it goes back to Fleur or. Is maybe in 3D. So let me say more generally, if you take a four-dimensional manifold that's not closed, and you see it as a cobordism between closed three-dimensional manifolds. So you will associate a linear map between some vector spaces. So which version? Yeah, the version you need. So you have a field theory. These are vector spaces. So there is a four-dimensional field theory in the sense that you have a four-dimensional manifold. That's a cobordism between three-dimensional manifolds. So your three-dimensional manifold, you have set vector space and maps. So the work of Ozvat and Sabu, I think. Yeah. And this works also, so you have something for three manifolds. And you can make sense of that for knots. This was something that was done independently by Rasmussen. And now you can go down one more dimension. So if you have two closed surfaces and a three manifold, so this vector space now is going to become a bimodule. Over these algebras. And that's Lipschitz-Oswarth-Abo theory. Oswarth-Thurston, sorry. OK, so there is a 2, 3, 4 TQFT. I should say partial because it doesn't work. It's not like you can't allow all types of corners, and then the surface, they need to be decorations, they need to be spin structures, etc. But that's essentially what you get. And so the idea is that at the end, you're not so much interested in surfaces, but the more you are able to compute this map, you're able to compute these vector spaces, or the one, the homology, Egar-Fleur knot homology, by cutting things into pieces. And so at the end, you rely on surfaces. So Douglas and Manoescu had the idea of trying to go down to dimension one. And I mean, it should be really GL11, so GL1 plus, so it's more like the open theory. Anyway, it's not really S1, it's S1 with a mark point. It's more like an interval, so it fits with the idea that you might have a bit of theory should extend partially to dimension, to a point. And so what we could construct with an Emanuel is we could show that the tensor product there will be compatible with what you expect. So you need your surfaces to have also handle decomposition, so there are extra information. But out of that, this will correspond to the tensor product of true rep. Okay, so what you can do in general, if you have a surface sigma with this in boundary of sigma, so this is actually a requirement for Egar-Fleur invariant, so that when you want to compute the symmetric power, what you're supposed to do is take the Foucaillère category of the G is the genus symmetric power of sigma, and you need to do some wrap Foucaillère category, you need some condition, and this will, you will need to have a circle in boundary to make sense of that. Otherwise, there's no, so far there's no invariant, nothing you can do with this sigma. So anyway, when you have that, this is something that will give you an action of GL11 plus. To that, you get a true rep on the algebras that were associated by Lipschitz-Oswarth-Sabo. Okay, so somehow we've gone from the 4, 3, 2. Now these algebras themselves are acted on by something. So. And they're acted on by this whatever monoidal category associated to GL1 plus. And it's in a way so that if you have a surface like this, so there will be three actions of GL1 plus, an action coming from this circle, an action there, an action there. And when you talk of being able to have a tensor product, it does come from an object like that. And so thanks to that, so that means you can recover and you can show, I mean, that algebras, so you can get any somehow A of sigma from the, like you can, doing tensor products and some fixed point constructions, you can construct a lot of those A sigmas, and you can construct any surface, you can cut it into pieces, and if you have building bricks, which will be from A of what building mix you need. You'll need thing like that, which will be trivial, and then you'll need. It's a little bit funny because you need this embedded circle in the boundary, and the performance. So you need only the trivial representation, and this will correspond to C2. So more with these and tensor product, you can reconstruct everything you need. Or in terms of the surface, you chunk into pieces, cut into pieces using pair of pants, and those you can construct any surface. So at the end, so we can recover some old algebras of Lischitz of Wasserstein, or algebras of sigma. We can recover them as two representations of GN11 plus from some elementary bricks. So there is a, it's a, what we've obtained is something like a 2D field theory valued in two representations of GL11 plus, but some of the interesting things from the point of view of topology is not 2D. I mean, you do that to be able to compute things in 3D. But so to go to 3D, the first thing we need is something like an R matrix, or something like a building. But for that, you do need the full GL11. Representation of U of GL11 plus, something like that is not going, or the UQ version, is not going to be braided. You have to take the full quantum group, okay? So you have to take this double, and we know, I mean, we sort of know what to expect, but it's, if up to quasi-isomorphism, everything disappears, so it's hard. Everything becomes trivial, so it's, there are some subtlety there that do not, that we have avoided so far. So on the GL11 side, we are still stuck at plus, but we can do good, lots of things with tensor product. On SL2, Kac-Moody, we can get the full quantum group, the full algebra, but tensor product is more problematic. So I'll stop here. Thank you. Is it a man? Yes, sir. Yes, sir. Yes and no. So yes, if you know up to homotopy. So up to homotopy, it's not. I don't think it's going to. So if you were to look at the actions on the derived category, then out of the E, you probably can't recover things. But if you look really at the action on the DG level, like we've done, then yes, it's plausible that F is determined. It's plausible, but. It's not. I'm not certain, but yeah. It's a fact. Yeah. It's annoying. Yeah. But we know. I mean, the work of Oswald Sabo, the recent work, particular, is extremely. I mean, from is very complicated. I mean, they have they do say invariance of not the way the more recent way to do that. I don't think so. With the infinity structures is the most complicated. Bimodule homological algebra or thing I've ever seen. I mean, the formula doesn't fit on on the page. I mean, they have it's incredibly complicated. So one should expect that it's going to be subtle to get to put the F in to put the other side. Like the R matrix or whatever. I mean, this is not going to be the formulas are very, very complex. The example, what's amazing there is that we're trying to make sense of a theory, but we already have lots of examples, extremely subtle theory. So I mean, you can't get wrong. I mean, you know what you should get, and it's very complicated. So we have to find a way to produce that. Does it give that gives that, and that gives something that hopefully would be a braided monoidal structure. So you can define some more braiding, but it's really three, four categories. You need then you need to check the so the fact that it satisfies the braiding means that not only two things are isomorphic, not only a diagram commutes, but you need to specify. And this new arrow should satisfy the homologic of tetrahedron equation. So Okay, so I gave up before. I mean, so far, I think when you get to a higher category things, it's probably not a good idea to have to do verification like that. So you should have some abstract construction for which it's tautological that these things will work, and then you compute it and you get formulas. But somehow this is going the other way around, and that's maybe not reasonable. But yes, there should be a breeding, and it should satisfy the should give a monoidal to better monoidal to category. I mean, there are two versions, and should satisfy the one you want.